who will watch this on Facebook Live and also on our YouTube. This is Sydney, Australia. We're in the middle of the day. We usually start about 12 o'clock midday on Sunday. And of course, this is the 2nd of October now. It was the first yesterday, and officially our first day of summer. But even though it's looking like winter at the moment, we know that above the clouds, the sun always shines, and when it shines here in Australia, it's pretty hot. So the first day of summer here has been cool one, and we've turned our clocks. So we're early for those people that are expecting us. We're early for them because we turn our clocks forward 1 hour. So we thank you, Lord, for the Facebook Live we're doing today. And here on YouTube, we send it out to our mailing list. Now, if you're not on our mailing list and you'd like to be, you go to trafficbuilder3.com and send us a message. That's the easiest way. Just send us a message, and your message will have your email. And so we'll put you on our list, and we'll pray for you every day. If you have a specific prayer request, put it there, and we will pray for you. We pray for India and Africa and all kinds of places all over the globe. However, we are called to be missionaries to the Southeast China Seas. And my wife's Filipina.
Hello, this Ernie Nett.
Yeah. And my son Joshua will come and read for us a little bit later. We're going to start off with I'm a New Creation. It's one of the golden oldies. But we're talking about salvation today and a few other things. I'm a new creation.
I'm a new creation. I'm a brand new man. All things have passed away. I've been born again. More than a conqueror.
That's who I am. I'm a new creation. I'm a brand new.
Purpose, the Son of God was manifest, and we're talking a little bit about that today, that we can triumph over principalities and powers and wicked spirits. And so this song talks about overcoming the principalities and powers of wicked spirits. And Jesus, or Godhead, the Godhead of the Father, Son, Holy Ghost, are triumph over all principalities, powers, even though there are wicked spirits around. Jesus is Lord over all. Amen.
For this purpose was the Son of God manifest. For this purpose was the Son of God manifest. To destroy the works of the evil one. The work of the evil one. No principality or power can stand before my Lord.
my door.
He made a show of him
openly, triumphant over defeat.
Jesus died on the cross of
Calvary. Jesus died on the cross of Calvary. To heal the bodies and set them free. To heal the bodies and set them free.
Now
resurrected body with the power can stand before my Lord.
He made a show of them
openly, triumphant over them.
Believing on the cross of
Calvary.
Yes,
believing on the cross of Calvary.
Salvation will come and a victory.
Salvation will come and a victory.
Now,
principality is a power can stand before my Lord.
He made a show of them
openly, triumphant over the enemy.
One more time. But Jesus died on the cross
of Calvary. Jesus died on the cross of Calvary. The bodies and set them free. To heal the bodies and set them free.
Yeah. Hallelujah. To heal the bodies and set them free.
That's what it's all about.
Hallelujah.
So is my beautiful wife. She's going to sing us a song, and she's going to give it, I don't know, testimony, preach. She's
no,
going to do everything.
Continue the word of God.
So we're going to share my time today with Erlinette. And Joshua is going to come and read for us in Thessalonians, where we was talking about last week. So we've been talking about the great catching away, and we shall finish on that today. And Elinette is going to sing for us. It sort of brings out your voice. But do we have that? We make that request to my son.
No, nobody's perfect. So,
can you do that?
We apologize for inconvenience, for distraction.
We
in the name of Jesus.
Sing this song when you believe.
Yes, Lord. We are here to worship with the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. We thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Father God, we thank you for your anointing on the song and for your anointing upon her. Then help her to sing that way, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord. Now we are not afraid, although we know this much to fear. We were moving mountains long before we knew we could. There can be miracles when you believe. Do hope is praying, it's hard to keep. Who knows what miracles you can achieve when you believe? Somehow you will. You will when you. Hope seems like a summer breeze to swiftly flown away. Yet now I'm standing here, my heart's so full, I can't explain. Seeking faith and speaking words, and every word I say. Hard to keep. Who can achieve. When you believe, somehow you win. You will when you believe. They don't always happen when you ask, and it's easy to give in into your fears. But when you're blinded by your pain, can't see the way, get through the rain. A small but every second point says hope is buried here. When you believe, somehow you win. Somehow you win. You will when you believe. You will when you believe. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Hallelujah. Thank you.
You know, we thank you, Lord, for this opportunity that we're able to sing. You know, some other people, they're able to sing because of lots of sickness, lots of things. That, you know, I would like, first of all, I would like those who don't know me, I would like to introduce myself. My name is Erlinette Kizo Richards, and I'm married with Reverend Brian Richards. So our ministry called Faith Restoration Church, Word of Faith Restoration Church International. So welcome to our church Facebook Live today. And thank you, Lord, I have a task today to continue the Word of God about salvation. And the first question that I have to ask is, what we must to do to have salvation? What we must to do to have salvation? Number one, we must repent our sins and be baptized in the name of Jesus. So this scripture I was reading last Sunday, but I have to read it again. In Mark 16:5, it says, Jesus said, "Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature." In Mark 16:16, it says, Jesus said to his disciple when he was risen from the dead, he said, "Be baptized, and if you don't baptize, you will be damned." So importante judi ay nga maghinusulta sa atong mga sala aron maluwas ta o magpabautismo ta sa tubig. Kung dili ta magpabautismo, will be damned. It means go to hell. And we receive salvation in Christ through repentance and faith, atong madawat ang atong kaluwasan. Pinaagi sa paghidulsol sa atong mga sala. So we need to repent and to repent our sin to get salvation. Maghinusol, repentance is very important too. It means turning away from sin ways. And we don't sin no more. Dili na ta magpakasala pag-usab. Kung munang ang repentance means, dili na ta magpakasala pag-usab. Ato nang Biyaan ang atong mga sala o dili na tabag pakasala. Muna siya truly repentance. Ang giingon sa Ginoo nga mo repenta to have salvation. And turning to God, mubalik ta sa atong Ginoong Jesucristo. You know? And He forgive our sin. Iyan yung tangpasaluon sa atong mga sala kung magpas, ano ta, maginuso ta sa atong mga sala. Iyan yung pagapution, yun siya, bisag kung sa pag, itong sa atong sala, iyan pagapution. And set you on a path to life Him. He said, acknowledge Jesus in all your ways and He direct your path. So, repentance, have faith in God, believe that He is our Savior, obey and follow His word until the end of our lives. Musalig ka sa atong Ginoong Jesucristo na siya mong atong manluluwas ug ang atong tumanon ug sundon ang iyang pulong, which is the Bible. No? Ang iyang pulong, which is the Bible, hangtod sa katupusan sa atong kinabuhi. In Tagalog, mananalig tayo sa ating Panginoon. Sundin natin ang kanyang salita hanggang sa kamatayan. So we need to read the Bible always. You know, because the Word of God is so powerful. The Word of God is healing into our bodies. It's life. It's our weapon. You know, in spite of circumstances. It's our weapon. It says in John 15:5, it says, if you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish and it will give it to you. I would like to remind you that some of the verse that I'd like to give it to you is translated to my Bisaya language, because I was born in Philippines, the Bisaya and the Tagalog, a little bit of Tagalog language, which is our national language in Philippines. So it says, God said, if you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish and it will give it to you. That's God's promise to us. Yadyo na siyang promise sa atoa. We need to give time to read the Bible. Give time, Jude. Number one, yun na ang pulong sa Ginoo. Dili ang mobile phone. Next na na ang mobile phone. You know? Very important ang pulong sa Ginoo. Dili na to isipirit ang Word of God. He is number one. His word is so powerful. His word is healing. Magagagahong yun ang iyang pulong. Tamin na siya. It's a weapon. Healing in our bodies. Kuno, kung magsakit ta, if we are sick, if you use the word of God, if you speak the word of God, that is healing in our bodies. It's very powerful medicine in our bodies. And life, kinabuhi din na siya. Ang pulong sa Ginoo, kinabuhi. Atong kinabuhi, ang pulong sa Ginoo. Whatever we ask, He will give it to us. See? God promised us. If we read the Bible and pray, He promised us. Bisag unsay atong Panginoon sa Ginoo, iyan yung pagatumanon. Ha? Dili jud mapakyas ang iyang mga promise, ang iyang mga saad kanato kung tumanon niya ang kung tumanon nato ang iyang pulong. Muna'y gusto sa Ginoo. So, number three, what we must do to have salvation? See, I remind you, repent and be baptized. And then number three, we need to have faith. Remember, faith is a substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. But faith, by faith, we receive healing. Madawat na ito ang kaayuhan sa atong mga sakit. Pinaagi sa imong pagtuo sa Ginoo. Kinahanglan na adutay pagsalig sa Ginoo. Kung nakinahanglan ka og healing sa imong sakit, doon na adutay pagtuo. Kung wala kay pagtuo sa Ginoo, dili gud ta mamaayo. Ha? Dili gud ta maayo. We need have faith on Him. Nga dili gud ta magduduha. No doubt, no wavering. Mao na di kinahanglan sa Ginoo nga doon na dito ay faith. And redemption. We need redemption because it says in the word, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or any symptoms of cold and flu or COVID symptoms dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Pinaagi sa ngalan ni Jesus Kristo, mamaayo jud ta ang iyang ngalan, magagahog gayud na. In the name of Jesus, demon, flies away from me. Cold and flu, flies away from me. Addiction, flies away from me. You know, that's what we need. We need to rebuke in the name of Jesus. Repentance. God created us in His image. He gave us will and freedom to choose to do disobey Him or you go on your way. We call that sin. You know, if you go on your way, masala din na siya, ah? So, ganahan yung kong manabako. You want to smoke, you want to drink, that's a sin. But you like to do that. Why? Because you like to do that. That's your habits. But that's a sin. You know? Yeah? That's a sin that you go on your own way. You know? Separate us from God. Sin is separate from us, God. So if we commit sin, we are separate from God. But God forgive us sin. That's why, God, we need to repent our sin. Huh? Number one, to have salvation, repent. No. Mag-ano dyan ta? Kung makasala ta? Ano dyan ta? Repent dyan ta? You know, I would like to share with you about my dad. You know, my dad really, to be honest, my dad was a smoker. He drink a lot, you know, but he is a good man. He drink and he smoke, but he's working hard. He was a driver of the bus and he gave us food. He provide us, but he has these vices that he couldn't stop. You know, he was drunk all the time. After his driving, he drunk. But I could tell he loves us. He's still for providing us. He's a good man. He's kind, but he's had bad vices. And one time, you know, my mom and me, we decided to go to Ba'i City. There was that Ba'i City. I was born on that place, and we heard that there is something revival. You know, like there was a American couple. There are evangelist and prophetic. And they have a gift of healing, you know. And they have a very huge people there in the park, like a rally. We call it a rally, Brian.
Yeah.
Yeah, rally, prayer rally. And we went there. We went. And then I've been witness the miracles actually, that the deaf can be able to hear, and there was paralyzed, he's able to walk. I've been witness of miracles, and I was started to believe at the time that God is really real. You know, go, wow, that is real. I've been witness a lots of miracles. And then when that evangelist, he called to all the vices people, like mga bisyo ba, mga bisyo. He said, all the have a lot of vices, come in front. Surrender to the Lord everything, your vices that you cannot stop. Your cigarettes, drink. And then my dad, when I look at my dad, my mom look at, are you alright, pa? Okay lang ka pa? Because my papa shaking. And he's very wet. Go, oh, pa, noon sa mas papa ma? I ask my mom, ting. I don't know what happened to me. And then this evangelist, American, said, go in front and surrender all your vices. Repent and surrender all your vices and God will forgive you. My papa, crying. Thing, so what are we going to do, thing? Are you all right? Sakit ba ka, thing? Are you sick? We panic. And then the evangelist called all the vices, all the people addicted with drinks, addicted with cigarettes. And ang papa ko, ni ano, nilakaw, gahilak, gakurog. He came in front. You know, he raised his hand and he cried, Lord, and crying. And I could see the repenting of that. My papa, he's repented. He cried. All the vices repented and crying. And then I'm crying too. I could feel, and I was convicted. And I could feel. And you know what? The evangelist prayed. My papa is shaking, crying, and he really surrendered. Lord, forgive me. I've heard many people ask repenting of their sin, you know, and crying. I could feel the presence of the Lord at the time. I was crying also too. And you know, my papa really said, surrender everything, all your vices, and God will forgive you. And you know, papa, he got his Marlboro. You know Marlboro, right? Did people know Marlboro? Cigarette, Marlboro. He got a pack of Marlboro in his pocket.
Yeah.
I've seen he throw his Marlboro, boom, in front of the evangelist. And the evangelist prayed over him. And he's shaking. And he fall over. And he's crying. Ooh, he cried. He doesn't know why he's crying. And he said, like that. And he's repenting, Lord, forgive me. Forgive me my sin. I could see the papa is repenting. And he forgive. And I think this is, okay, a few minutes. Okay, I really like to do this, you know, because this is a true story. And I would like to know that God will forgive you. And you know what, my papa, I'm happy because he gave up. He gave up for many years. He was a smoker. He was alcoholic, but he gave up. And thank you, Lord. Papa was changed. And you know, after maybe a week, his friend he visited, and he's trying to tempt my dad. Think. Kumusta ka ting? I haven't seen you for a month. Chaa, I'm okay. You look great, kid ting. Chaa, I'm okay. My papa is looking good, you know. He become active. He's really changed. He was changed after that. And my, this man, he's a demon, you know. He's a thing. Would you like a cigarette? Your favorite, Marlboro? My papa was really tempted, Brian. Chaa, I miss that. Papa forget straight away. He forget, you know. He doesn't like the taste anymore. See? And that is, God is really changing him. He doesn't want the taste anymore. He surrendered. And God, at the time, I'm happy. We are happy that Papa stopped his vices. And I would like to continue this very good about salvation. And we'll see you next week, okay? My husband would continue to expand this because he's has a great knowledge. I'm not really a pastora. But I would like to encourage you what I've learned about the Word of God, how God changed me, that I believe that I have salvation. In Jesus' name, amen.
God calls us to use our gifts and use them wisely. And no man is totally complete without God. Even the preachers, they can't do it all. And I believe that many pastors that have been made pastors, they shouldn't be pastoring without a wife. And I'm talking to Filipinos when I say this, that lots of, in Philippines, there's lots of men and women that are pastoring churches without a partner. And that is the biggest mistake of them all. Because when God calls a person to be pastor, I'm not talking about the other gifts of the evangelist or whatever, I'm talking about pastoring. When God calls a man or a woman to be pastor, he never calls them singular. He always calls them as a couple to pastor a congregation, to pastor a church. And no man can be complete without that woman side of the ministry, you understand? And so with Elinette is a tremendous blessing to me, even though I have lots of knowledge of the Word of God, and you might have degrees after my name and all of that. I am not complete in God without a partner like Elinette. Without a wife like Elinette, it would not be possible to be a very, very good pastor. And so God doesn't call men or women to be pastors by themselves. He calls them to be partners together. Because, you know, one of the silliest things that I've ever heard of is that the government supplies money to ministers to be marriage guidance counselors. Government gives money for people to be marriage guidance counselors, and yet the priest, or the particularly Catholic priests, are not allowed to be married. And you know, that is, seems to me a very silly thing to do, and that is to make a minister, a particular Catholic priest, a minister of marriages. What would he know about marriage, you know? And what would he know about troubles in marriage? He would know by a textbook, but you know, your own experience, when you are a counselor, you counsel by your own experience and the knowledge of God, of what you have experienced. And so when we share like we do, we are sharing our own personal experience using the Word of God together, you understand? So it's not just knowledge of God that we have, but it's our own personal experiences that completes the message. And so you'll be tried and tested on what you know, but you'll also be tried and tested in your own personal life. You preach prosperity and you see the challenge and the test come on your finances. You preach healing and you see the challenge and the trial and the test come on your personal well-being. And it's always been like that. The reason why is that we wrestle not with flesh and blood, but with principalities and powers and wicked spirits from in high places. You know, and this is what we started to tell you, that, you know, we sang a song, "For this purpose was the Son of God manifest, that he might destroy the works of the evil one." So Jesus came to destroy the works that the devil had already implanted right from Adam and Eve. He took control, you know. He deceived Adam and Eve and took control of the known world at that time. And in the world today, he is still the God of this world. Not your God or my God that we serve, but he is the God, the ruler of this world. In 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 4, you will see the God of this world. And just in case I don't get time to go through all of what I want to say today, I'll give you these scriptures. I want you to write them down and study it out for yourself. And if I don't complete it today, I'll complete it next week. So what I've just shared on is 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 4, that it says that the God of this world has blinded the mind to stop you from seeing the light of the glorious gospel. Now that's not the God we serve, that is the God who deceived Adam and Eve, who now become Satan. But he didn't become straight away Satan. He was an upright being when he was cast out of heaven, and the iniquity was found in him. He was cast out of heaven and came to earth, and he was an upright being. He was something beautiful to behold, and therefore Adam and Eve, you know, trusted and believed what he said, and they got deceived. And so we can talk about that another day. What was the true sin or the true deception? We can talk about that another day. But 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 4 says that the God of this world has blinded the eyes to stop them from seeing the light of the glorious gospel. In other words, there's lots of people, they only see bad in, they don't see the good, you know, they only see the bad. And until you are born again, you will only see the fallen nature of each other, and you not look for the good. You try to get positive. Now the world is waking up. The world is changing now. From when I was a young boy, the world is getting clever now, and they're saying that, you know, you have to have a positive attitude, and so the power of positive thinking, it puts you over, which it will, even for the unsaved person, put you over. But that's doing it in their own strength. There is a truth in that power of positive thinking. There is a strength in that. There is a truth in that, and it will work for you until the chips are down. You'll go back to either drinking or smoking or lying, cheating. And why? Because you still have the fallen nature. You need to be born again. You need to have a new experience in God. You need to allow Jesus Christ to live his life through you. And that's what being born again is. And so if you're born again and you allow Jesus to come into your life and live his life through you, you can sing that song in 2 Corinthians 5:17. I'm a new creation. Old things pass away and all things become new. 2 Corinthians 5:17. So I want you to write these scriptures down. 2 Corinthians 4:4, 2 Corinthians 5:17, Ephesians 6:12 to 16. That's where we're going now. And then 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 and verse 13. And then 1 Thessalonians 5 and verse 8. And that is, we'll see how far we get today. Hopefully we'll cover most of it. So I want to prayerfully read these scriptures over the people that would be listening today. My name is Reverend Brian Richards. Like my wife said, we are Word of Faith ministers, and we're here with a vision of restoration. I came here, I left here 43 years ago, this area, and I went to live in the mid-north coast. God has called me back to this place, and I tell you, I am really shocked and disappointed in some ways, but shocked to find the falling away of the faith. It's not necessarily, you know, the Bible talks about a falling away. They'll, before, you know, anything, before you see a revival or before you see a restoration, there'll be a falling away of the church first, falling away in the body of Christ. And really, you see, you can, some people can come and see an increase, you see. There is an increase, but there's a falling away of the real faith, the true faith that was originally given to the church. And there's a compromise comes in. You know, like Eleanor was saying, that the Bible says, in John 16:15, that, you know, those that believe shall be baptized. I mean, if you don't believe, you're not going to be baptized, you see. But those that believe and are baptized shall be saved. But if you're not going to believe, then you're not going to be saved. But some would dare to be baptized and still not believe the way we should believe. So, you know, it's believing. What do you believe today? And as a result of your believing, you'll be baptized and you'll be saved. But do you get baptized to join the church of whatever denomination you're in? It makes no difference what denomination. It's not the denomination that's written in the Lamb's Book of Life. It's your individual name. If you have your name written in the Lamb's Book of Life, you shall be saved. You'll be an overcomer, and you'll be sitting at the throne of God if you're an overcomer. But if you get baptized and you say, well, I'm baptized, I'm saved. No, that's not what the Bible says. It says those that believe and are baptized, you're baptized as a result of believing. You don't get baptized to join a denomination. You don't get baptized because the preacher is preaching on water baptism this week. Oh, I'll get baptized, you know, because you want to belong to that church. How about belonging to the kingdom of God? How about allowing Jesus to come into your life and direct you through his word? You know, you don't be directed by the church doctrines. The church doctrines may be good, they may be not good. But the fact is, you don't get baptized because that's what the denomination says is required. The requirement to join that church is to be baptized. And so, you know, you get baptized and you join the church because that's the requirement. No. You get baptized as a result of your believing, he said. And if you believe what the Bible says, not necessarily what the preacher says, because he might be wrong, but you check every word out, every word I preach, you check it out with the word of God, and if it doesn't say exactly what I'm saying, then you don't have to believe it that way. You see, and that's what makes different denominations around the world, because they believe differently. But I am disappointed when I come back to churches that have fallen away from the original doctrines that was given. And one of the original doctrines is that in John 16:15, that those that believe and are baptized shall be saved. And people get baptized for the wrong reasons. They're not necessarily believing the power and the name of Jesus Christ can transform them, you know. And they're actually saying that, you know, some denominations, I won't mention any particular denominations today, but you know who you are. There's some denomination that would say that this baptism is an outward manifestation of what an inward witness is. Sounds good, doesn't it? But that's not what the Bible says. You get baptized, there is a, you know, not just an outward expression of an inward witness, there is a real miracle that takes place through the waters of baptism. See, some people would say, this is just symbolic, you know. Let me read something else to you in Colossians 2. And some people would say, you know, it's only symbolic. It's not literal. Let me read something to you out of Colossians 2. It says, beware lest any man spoil you through the philosophy and vain deceit after the traditions of men and not after the rudiments of, and after the rudiments of the world and not after Christ, the anointing. See, Christ is the anointing. Christ is not Jesus' second name. Christ means the anointing of Jesus, or the anointed one. Christ means the anointing. So, after the traditions of men and the regiments of this world, and not after Christ. For in him dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and you are complete in him, which is the head of all principality and power. See, Jesus is the boss of all principality and power, and you use his name to overcome, you see. And so, you are complete in him, which is the head of all principality and power, in whom you are circumcised with a circumcision made without hands. So there's a circumcision being made without hands. How do you do a circumcision, or cutting away, without using hands? Because it's the Spirit of God who does it. See, a circumcision, that is, that you are circumcised without hands in putting off the body of sin of flesh, and the circumcision of Christ, buried with him in baptism, wherein also you're risen with him through an operation of God. Did you hear what I just said? You are, when you're baptized, when you decide to be baptized, and you say, yes, I like the preaching, I want to have that life-changing experience through being born again and being baptized in Jesus' name. You see, now it says here, buried with him in baptism. So when you go into the waters of baptism, you bury your old man, your old life. You're buried with him in water baptism, and also you are also wherein you are risen with him. You're risen with him, with Jesus, through faith. See, it takes faith. Through faith of an operation of God who has raised him from the dead. See, just like God, the Spirit of God, the Father, the Holy Spirit, raised Jesus from the dead, this will happen to you. You don't have to die a literal death. You die a spiritual death. You die to the man that you was born, the man that grew up unsaved, that nature, that sinful nature that you're born with, dies in the waters of baptism, and you rise up in a newness of life in Christ Jesus with a new nature. It says that we become a partaker of his divine nature through water baptism. And it says here, through faith of an operation of God. See, God does a literal operation on your heart, on your nature, on your being. And a real miracle takes place in the waters of baptism. If just an outward expression of an inward witness, then that's all it is. It's just, you put it on a show for somebody. I don't know who. Maybe the pastor, maybe the church. You know, because people look at you and they say, oh, you've been baptized, Ed. You know, you're not really a member of the church until you're baptized. And, you know, I was told this and I was only visiting the church, Baptist church at the time. And the pastor said, well, when you're ready, Brian, I'll baptize both of you and you'll be members of the church. I thought, oh, well, if, you know, if you're not going to recognize that I'm already saved, you know, then... And so when you are saved and you're truly saved and you're truly baptized, you'll show forth the fruit of the Holy Spirit, which we sing about. You know, love, joy, peace, love, suffering. Galatians 5:22 and goes on, talk about the fruit that shouldn't have, the fruit that you should have. And you being dead to your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh, as he quickened together with him, having forgiven you of your trespasses, blotting out the handwriting, the ordinances, all those accusations that would be against us, he's blotted out and nailed it to the cross, having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in it. Let no man therefore judge you and meet to drink or respect of holidays or new moons or Sabbath days or whatever. Don't let any man judge you of whatever doctrines they think you should be holding up. Because God has delivered us from the law. God has delivered us from the curse of the law. And God has delivered us from the traditions of men. He says the traditions of men make the word of God to no effect. So therefore, there is only one law that you should keep, and that is love the Lord thy God with all your heart, soul, and mind, and all your strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. By these commandments, all the Ten Commandments hang upon them. And if you haven't got love, the true love of God, you're not even saved. And you keeping the Ten Commandments won't get you saved either. If you could get saved by keeping the Ten Commandments, Jesus Christ would not have to come. But he came to pay the price. To pay the price. And if you've been holding the Ten Commandments all your life, there's still a price to pay. And that is the wages of sin is death. So either you die or somebody dies in your place. And Jesus is the one who died in your place. And as you take him and you say, Lord, I want to make you Lord of my life. I want you to come and live your life through me. You become Christian. That's what a disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ really is. But I see so much compromise in a so-called body of Christ. You know what I mean? So much compromise within the churches. You feel lonely. You know that? You feel lonely all of a sudden. And you know what it is? It's not you, it's them. They're not saved. You're fellowshipping with people that are unsaved. And it says in my Bible, get out. Come out from among them. Because they're not saved. And God will lead you to a place where you can be spoon-fed the word of God. And you grow up. You grow up. You really do grow up in spiritually. And you become a leader. Because Jesus said, go and preach the gospel all over the world. Right? And even amongst Jesus' disciples, there was a couple of married men that was pastors, like Timothy. You know? But if you're a pastor, that doesn't exclude you from being evangelist as well. Because even Apostle Paul told Timothy to go out and witness and preach the gospel everywhere. And Timothy had his own house, his own wife and family, and Jesus went and preached in his house. Even ripped the roof off them and lowered the body down. You don't think that they would, they've missed their chance. You don't think they've missed their chance to arrest Jesus when they ripped the roof off and they lowered this body down? And Jesus prayed and said, pick up your bed and walk. They was really looking for an excuse to arrest Jesus, you know. But they knew they couldn't because that house belonged to Peter. See that? If it belonged to any other dignity, they would have arrested him then. So Peter was a married man. And yeah. Okay, so we go to Ephesians 6 just very quickly. We've got about 5 minutes, I think. We're a little bit all over the shop today, but I just hope that you get blessed out of what I'm sharing. Ephesians chapter 6, and we'll read from 12 to 16. Ephesians chapter 6. Ephesians chapter 6, 12 to 16, it says, for we wrestle not, this is what I want you to pick up today, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood. In other words, other people. It's the spiritual war that we're in. We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers, against powers and against rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Therefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, having done all to stand. Stand therefore, having done all to stand, stand therefore. Anytime you see the word stand, it means hold fast. Hold fast to what? Hold fast to this word. Hold fast to your confession of your faith. Hold fast and stand in the Lord, in the Spirit of the Lord. See? Stand therefore, having your loins girded about with truth, having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, take the shield of faith, wherein you shall be able to quench every fiery dart of the wicked one. Isn't that wonderful? Shield of faith. Take the helmet of salvation. Now, what's so important about the helmet of salvation? You take the helmet of salvation, you put a helmet on, so it's going to protect your head, but it's going to protect your mind. You see that? The real battleground is the mind. One of my teachers, Carl Stringer, I love him very much, he used to say, he used to have this explosive personality, and he used to come in and he used to say, you know, to us students, he'd say, have a checkup from the neck up as soon as you get up. Because this is the battleground in the mind. And you know, even Cassius Clay, the old boxer there, you know, he knew that if he could beat him in the mind, he got him beat.
Yes.
He didn't have to lay a glove on him, you know, he got him beat him in the mind. And this is where Satan tries to work. Works on your mind, and if he can defeat you in your mind, he can defeat you in the body, and therefore sickness comes on you. See that? And that's what Elinette was referring to, that if you educate your mind and believe, you've got to believe, but if you can say the words, say it over and over again, you've got to believe it because you're going to see a manifestation of it.
Yeah.
Above all, take the shield of faith, wherein you shall quench every fiery dart of the wicked. Take the helmet of salvation and the word of sword, sorry, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Which is the word of God. You take the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. And it says, the word of God is like a sword that appears to divide the joints of the matter, and it is a discerner of the intents of the heart.
Mm-hmm.
I haven't got time to go into that. But Thessalonians 4, we're getting to where you, Joshua, is that 4 or 5? 5, I said to you. Okay. I'm just going to read one scripture there in Thessalonians 4, and then we get Joshua to read. Thessalonians 4 and verse 13 says, better is a fool
and a wise
man. These ribbons, you put them in the place, the right place, and you get the right scripture. Okay, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 13, it says, But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep. It's talking about people that have passed away, that have died, but they're in faith. So therefore, you're only asleep, because you're going to be resurrected, okay?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And it says, I would not have you be ignorant, brethren, concerning them that are asleep, that you sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. You see, don't be sorrowful for those that have died and you're wondering whether they're saved or not. You see, only God knows their heart. And you know, if a person dies somewhere between the initial salvation and the completion, because we are saved when we're born again, we are being saved and we shall be saved, meaning it's a progression of what we believe. And as you believe, you're responsible for what you know. See, But how can you be responsible for what you don't know? You see, you can't. His Bible says, for him who knows to do right and does not, for him it's sin.
Yeah.
So therefore, you get born again by your confession of faith, and you ask Jesus come into your life, and then Jesus says to you, through his word, you go now and get baptized. And you don't do it. Or you procrastinate and you say, I'll do it later or whatever. Only God knows your heart. And it says in Romans chapter 2 that you will be judged according to your conscience.
Yes.
What is water baptism? The result of water baptism is having a good conscience towards God. You see that? And so if you was not baptized, but your intentions was to be baptized, or your intentions was to follow God, and because you love the word of God, you love God with all that you have. And then, well, that's what the requirement is, to love the Lord God with all your heart, with all your soul, with your mind. Your intentions was to be obedient to God, but baptism was never really presented to you the way I have presented to you today. And if that was the case, then you'd be judged according to your conscience, Romans chapter 2 tells you that, all right? So those that are dead in Christ shall rise first, according to this scripture. Those that are dead in Christ shall rise first, for the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of archangels, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. You know what the trump of God is? The message that we're preaching right now. This is the last trump. This is the last trump, that the dead in Christ shall rise first, then we which are alive shall remain, shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Comfort one another, wherefore comfort one another with these words. God bless you. I want Joshua to come now to read Thessalonians 5, is that right? That one? Yeah, okay. The reason why I get Joshua to come and read it is because I'm going to get distracted if I read it myself. I'll get Joshua to read it. Then we continue. God bless you.
We'll just pray for.
Hello, my name is Joshua Brian Richards. Today I'm going to be reading from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. Remember to like, comment, and subscribe if you're on Vimeo, Dailymotion, or YouTube. Also subscribe and press the notification bell, and you'll be notified of every time we upload a video. Hello to Facebook. You can buy Dad's books at chatcreator2.com, and it's main list at referentriches.com. Okay. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 in the King James Version. But of the times and the seasons, brethren, you have no need that I write unto you. For yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so cometh as a thief in the night. For when they say, peace and safety, then sudden destruction cometh upon them, as travail upon a woman with child, and they shall not escape. But you, brethren, are not in darkness, that that day should overtake you as a thief. You are all children of life, and the children of the day. We are not the children of the night, nor of darkness. Therefore, let us not sleep, as do others, but let us watch and be sober. For they that sleep, sleep in the night, and they that be drunken are drunken in the night. But let us, who are of the day, be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love, and for an helmet of salvation. For God has not appointed us to wrath, but to obtain salvation by our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, that whether we wake or sleep, we should live together with him. Wherefore, comfort yourselves together and edify one another, even as also you do. And we beseech you, brethren, to know them which labor among you, and are over you in the Lord, and admonish you, and to esteem them very highly in love for their work's sake, and be at peace among yourselves. And we now we exhort you, brethren, warn them that are unruly, comfort the feeble-minded, support the weak, be patient toward all men. See that none render evil for evil unto any man, but ever follow that which is good, both among yourselves and to all men. Rejoice evermore, pray without ceasing. In everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. Quench not the spirit, despise not prophecies, prove all things, hold fast that which is good, abstain from all appearance of evil, and the very God of peace sanctify you wholly. And I pray your whole spirit and soul and body be preserved blameless unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Faithful is he that calleth you, who also will do it. Brethren, pray for us. Greet all the brethren with a holy kiss. I charge you by the Lord that this epistle be read unto all the holy brethren. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
We just pray for those people that would like to be saved and those people that would like to give their lives to Jesus. And if you're making a commitment to water baptism, be sure to use the scriptures in Acts 19, 1 to 5, you read that and get the pastor to baptize you in Jesus' name, and you receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, with evidence of talking in tongues, the gift of the Holy Spirit, and the miracle is not in speaking many languages. The miracle is on the ears of the hearer. In Acts 2, 6, you'll see that the miracle was on the hearer. They heard the native language. It didn't say they spoke in many tongues. So if you've got a Bible that says they spoke in many languages, change it to many tongues, because they use the same tongue that we use today. And it was not many languages. They heard their native language. And I was in Philippines one time and I spoke in tongues and they understand me perfectly. I didn't speak in Tagalog or Visaya or whatever. I spoke in tongues and they heard their native language. And that's how it was on the day of Pentecost. So, let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for those people that are ready to make a commitment to Christ. If that's you today, I want you to repeat this prayer. Heavenly Father, I believe in Jesus.
I believe in Jesus.
I believe Jesus died for me.
I believe Jesus died for me.
On the cross.
On the cross.
And rose again from the dead.
Rose again from the dead.
I accept him as my Lord and Savior.
Accept you as my Lord and my Savior.
Come into my heart.
Come into my heart.
And make me born again.
Make me born again.
I believe I receive.
I believe I receive.
And I rejoice.
And I rejoice.
In Jesus' name. If you said that prayer with me today, or if you said that prayer before and you'd like to have recognition of that, then you go to trafficbuilder3.com and write us a message, and I shall receive that, and you'll be listed into our prayer mailing list, and I'll send you one of my books totally free, and you'll be blessed.
Hallelujah.
In Jesus' name. In
Psalms 37:1, it says, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I fear? The Lord is my strength, and he is my song. Whom shall I 1:7 says, God has not given us a spirit of fear, but a power, love, and sound of mind.
To be a part of our ministry, then we'd like to hear from you, and maybe we can meet and work together in evangelism in some other country like Philippines or wherever the Lord would lead us. So we're really blessed today, and we pray for our mailing list to grow. We pray, Lord, that this word would go forth with power and authority. We will not return void or empty, and release the anointing to the hearers, Lord. We pray in Romans chapter 1, verse 11, it says, I desire to be with you, that I may impart unto you some spiritual gift to the end that you be established. Let evangelism come, Lord God. Let healing come and deliverance come, in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. See you next week.